Hi there, I'm Seth Juarez, and I've got Nebojsa Jojic, principal researcher, and Lucas Joppa, chief environmental scientist at Microsoft, with me today to discuss an exciting initiative that applies AI to sustainability issues called AI for Earth. Welcome, my friends.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Awesome. Let's start first with, what is AI for Earth?
Yeah, well, so the world's got some pretty pressing problems. I think that's no secret. In my opinion, one of the biggest ones is the increasing impact of human activities on Earth's natural systems. And that really begs the question of how we're going to use all of this incredible technology and artificial intelligence that we're creating to help societies thrive in an increasingly resource-constrained world. Microsoft's been deeply committed to environmental sustainability for a long time, and that's why last week we announced the public availability of this new program, AI for Earth, which is really dedicated to deploying the full scale of Microsoft's AI services and technologies and research investments to organizations on the front lines of environmental sustainability, nonprofits, academics, and government entities, to help them solve environmental problems faster.
That's awesome that we have a chief environmental scientist on staff at Microsoft. First of all, what are the key areas for AI for Earth?
So AI for Earth as a program focuses on climate, agriculture, water, and biodiversity conservation. The way the program's actually set up is with three pillars. We're looking to provide access to organizations to all of Microsoft's AI technologies. We're also looking to provide education so that those organizations actually can take advantage of the services that we're making available. And then finally, we're also offering an opportunity to work directly with us as Microsoft employees to deliver some showcase projects. And so the demo that we're going to be showing today is actually an example with some partners where we bring all of that together, both access, education, and collaboration.
Awesome. So AI for Earth is using AI to help with environmental challenges that happen. All right, so let's look at this demo that you're talking about. Can we do that?
Yeah, we definitely can.
Awesome.
So this demo is all about you taking a deep learning approach to a pretty common task, which is trying to build land cover maps. So land cover maps are just classifying Earth's surface into things like forests, fields, water, impervious surfaces like roads and houses. So trying to go from those high-resolution images that people are so accustomed to looking at today and actually turning those into labeled data points. We've been working with two really important partners for this project. One's a small organization on the East Coast called the Chesapeake Conservancy.
Okay.
And another is a large software provider that is a major player in the GIS, or Geographic Information System software world, called Esri.
Of course.
Yeah. And what we've been doing there is Chesapeake Conservancy, with their partners, spent a lot of time and a lot of effort putting together a data set that's really kind of the first of its kind of high resolution, 1 meter resolution data set of the Chesapeake watershed on the East Coast. And the reason that that's so important is because for the first time, it provides us as AI researchers the opportunity to have an incredible training data set for a deep learning approach, right? Because the AI applications that we're building are so data hungry. And in environmental applications, we're oftentimes data poor. So this gives us an opportunity to drive a deep learning approach to create, hopefully, a first of its kind, a high resolution land cover map for all of the United States.
So before we get to the demo, why would a land cover map be important? Because I'm thinking AI for Earth, we're gonna program robots to pick up trash, but that's clearly not what we're talking about here. Why does this particular application help when it comes to environment?
Yeah, so for instance, land cover mapping in particular, it is the first thing that you need to know before you can start making appropriate environmental policy and managing our natural resources, right?
See.
So you need to be able to look down and understand what is where, how much is there, and how fast is it changing. Can you imagine trying to ask a financial services manager to manage an investment portfolio without letting them understand what's in their portfolio, what trades have been made, or anything
sense.
Like that?
Yeah, because I used to live in Las Vegas, and Lake Mead has gone down tons. And if you don't have a land cover map that shows you the differential, then you're not going to know what's actually happening.
That's right.
All right, let's see what you got, my friend.
So let's let's go here. So what I wanted to show you first was a set things in context for you a little bit. So what you're looking at here, this is Esri software called ArcGIS Pro that we're running this application in. And what you're looking at here is across the United States a 1 meter resolution open government data set. So this is produced by the US government through a program called the National Agricultural Imaging Service, mm-hmm. or program. Sorry, we're getting ourselves back up to speed here. Perfect, yeah, there we go, all right.
So tell us what we're looking at here, so people didn't get to see it.
Right, so what people are looking at here is a map of imagery across the United States that's okay. collected and made available for free by the US government.
Okay.
And then over here on the East Coast, you can see where there's a bunch of different colors of greens and blues. That's a map that this organization, Chesapeake Conservancy, with a bunch of their partners in the region, put together to convert that imagery into actually labeled data. So as we zoom in here, you can see that they've taken this imagery here and converted it into roads and houses, fields and forests, so that the computer can actually understand what that imagery represents.
And these are just vector data on top of an existing map.
That's right.
Awesome.
Exactly.
Now I'm starting to get understand it. Like I said, I had this dumb idea of robots picking up trash, but here we're actually looking at some vector data over real. But I'm noticing that the little green part is actually really small. Right, because I looked at the United States,
that's right.
And I saw like, hey, there's a big United States, and there's this. This is the only data we have, right?
That's right. And what's actually available for all of the United States right now is at 30 meter resolution, and it's 5 years old.
That's not helpful.
So yeah, if you're trying to manage lands in real time, it's almost impossible at the moment to deal with resolution that encompasses, you know, roads and houses and many other things all within one pixel.
Awesome.
And is over 5 years old.
So where's the, like, I understand, like, the mapping. I'm where's the machine learning part of it that we want to talk about?
So what we did was what we used this data set as training data for an algorithm that would then be able to be used across the United States. Right, so while this map is hugely useful in the Chesapeake watershed over on the East Coast, it's not all that useful everywhere else in the US. So how do we create a single algorithm that's capable of course, working where it was born and bred, right? But also capable of classifying land cover in Oakland County, Michigan, for instance. And I'll show you an example of this, how it all works.
Let's do it. And if I pause with questions, humor me a little bit, okay?
Yeah, please. No, please do. So I just wanted to show you the data set here, but what I'm going to show next is a web application that we built. So after training our model, we were able to just output that model file and host it in Azure and in Microsoft Cloud. That is something that could be queried with any imagery from anywhere. And so this is that same location in the Chesapeake watershed. And you can see that just with a click of a button, when I click here, this rectangle will become highlighted. The service will segment that image out, send it off to our model file, and in real time, send back a result that has the land cover classification. So you can see in just a few seconds, in that same region where it was trained, we were able to classify land cover almost instantaneously. And as you can see, quite accurately. We can also go up here and you can look at how we're doing with houses, for instance. And you'll see that there's two boxes that I'm showing here. One is the actual final guess that the algorithm is making. I think that's a road, a house, a forest, or a field. And then the one above it is actually a mixture of probabilities from the model. And that's really helpful from a research perspective, because I know we have a bit of a research audience mixed in with everybody watching today, because that really lets us understand how the algorithm is thinking. And that's what we might need to do to start to improve it. What additional training data sets do we need to show?
Can we go back to the picture here? Because this is pretty impressive. You're saying that you've taken this data. There you go. You can see it now. You've taken the actual data. You've trained it so that now the machine can automatically create the cover for it, essentially.
That's right.
And the one at the top is showing the distribution of where the sort of like the likelihood of this being like light green, I guess, is like grass, and
it's
dark green
it's
is
field,
for,
yes.
And green is for. And so the bottom is what it predicts. The top is here's how I feel generally about that.
That's exactly right. Because, you know, unless you have a perfect model, which statistically speaking, you kind of don't want to anyway for generality, there's a non-zero probability of it being any of these different classes, right? And so the model has to decide which is which ultimately. And so when you look at it this way, you get to see, oh, well, ultimately, in the bottom, it thinks that's Forrest and that's Field. But you can see there's a little bit of hesitancy one way or the other, and that really is helpful for us to be able to understand how to make this stuff better.
Now, Nebojsa, you've kind of been sitting here, but now I want to ask you, how is this done? What's the AI techniques?
So this project is actually similar to the previous segment that you were talking about, segmentation project.
Oh, of course, yeah.
The difference, I guess, one big difference is that instead of looking at lots of images that are segmented, lots of smaller images, we're looking at one huge image. This is 10 million kilometers squared. And as Lucas mentioned, we are trying to classify it at the resolution of 1 square meter. So it's one humongous image that we're trying to classify. And what we've been using here are these convolutional neural networks, which consists of multiple layers of processing. Each layer will convolve the image with a bunch of filters that automatically learn from the data. And then the output is going to be processed again. And we have dozens and dozens of these filters, of these layers. And then at the end, we have a classification of each pixel into its corresponding land cover label. We did have to change the tools that we started with. And we started with our cognitive toolkit, which worked fairly well. But in order to adapt it to this application, which hasn't been really used with this type of tools before, we had to innovate a little bit in terms of making the models more sensitive to shape rather than color. Because as you can imagine, you can have rivers that look one way or the other way. They could look very dark or very greenish or brackish,
right.
Or they could even look white if they're empty, which happens.
Oh my goodness.
To be able to be robust to all of these things, we had to change the representation a little bit to be more relevant, more relying on shape than color and texture. We are also looking at all of these things at multiple scales. And then basically what happens is you take all the data from Chesapeake Bay, you feed it into a learning algorithm, it runs for a few days, and out comes a model file that Lucas mentioned, which you can then use to classify things anywhere.
Now, does it generalize pretty well? Because I'm imagining, like, I'm putting it over, like, the middle of Nevada, and it's, is it going to, tell me about that.
Yeah, so I'll let Nebojsa speak to the technical aspects of that. We can show you one area where it does generalize, and then maybe as Nebojsa gives an example, we can show some places
that it
doesn't.
That was the next question, because we just tested it on, like, what we trained it on, and
that's
a good indication of, like, okay, it kind of works.
As you can imagine, in the areas which look similar to Chesapeake Bay, it's going to do very well.
Right.
And that's probably what we're going to show now, right?
Yep. So what I'm showing here is a land cover map in Oakland County, Michigan. This time.
Okay.
Okay. So we've moved from the east coast of the United States to
the
smack
middle,
in the middle,
middle,
right? And the reason that we've moved here is because this is a county that have also put together a 1 meter resolution land cover map for their jurisdiction, right? But this is a hugely resource intensive process for these organizations. And so they did this 7 years ago. And that's what you're looking at here.
So we're looking at and if we can get that back on the screen, we're getting the 7 year old data back here. This is seven years old.
That's right.
Okay, cool.
And this image is a year old.
Okay.
Of the exact same place. So you can see that a lot has changed.
Sure.
In particular, this intersection has gone from a T intersection
to a roundabout,
right? And of course, this is going on with housing developments, road developments, and many other things. And so if you're not staying current with if your algorithm isn't current updating you to much more current information, you can quickly fall further behind. So I'll just show, we'll zoom into that same location. Oops, sorry.
So now we're going to the location in Michigan that has really good data, but 5 years ago.
Yeah, and which our algorithm has never seen before.
Of course, and I'm looking at this and it looks a little different.
Yep. So we'll click here.
And so it's using the same model that we generated from the Chesapeake Bay.
That's right.
To predict what's going on here. Okay.
That's right. In a place, like we said, in a place that it's never seen before and where they have existing land cover maps, but which are now out of date.
Okay.
And you can see with the click of a button, we were able to update that old land cover map almost instantaneously, right?
That's amazing.
So that's a strong statement towards transferability, geographic transferability. We're still, I'm showing you one place where it works beautifully.
Sure.
There are many places still where it doesn't, and Nebojsa can talk a little bit about how we're moving forward to tackle that. Nevada is a great example where our algorithm currently thinks forests are deserts are forests, which is the is about as wrong as you can be.
But this is amazing though, because this makes it you can do, for example, you can sample areas that are representative, small areas that are representative of many of the areas in the United States, and then use those models to generalize over the entire landscape. Is that right?
That's true. And in addition, that's why I mentioned that we are trying to make the models more reliant on shape rather than color, so they generalize better. So for example, they work in Bellevue where I live and don't see the water over my house. Uh-huh. They actually are classifying now well in Seattle area. But beyond that, if you want to move to other sort of labels like swamps and whatever other people are interested in, different types of fields, agricultural developments and so on, then we could benefit from new types of label data. But we are trying to build these algorithms to require as little of label data as possible. So if a user downloads a new class or wants to correct our map somewhere, they can maybe work on 100 meters. And that our algorithm would then use that to generalize over acres in that area. So the way we are seeing this kind of going forward is that since we're not always going to be interested only in half a dozen classes that we're looking at right now, but even more, and we are going to be have to adapt to different types of landscape, then we are hoping and we're expecting actually that Esri users and other people interested in all of this would work on downloading that data into the same depot, which you can visualize through tools like this, and then everybody's work would then get amplified by these algorithms and would generalize over
all
the areas.
Amazing. So if someone out there is really concerned about the environment and they want to help out, hey, donate an hour of your time labeling some map that maybe we've never seen. We suggest here's 10 that you can work on. Yeah. They can set that, upload that. We retrain the neural network. It gets better, and then it can label even more stuff. Is that about
it? No, that's exactly right. That's the real power, I think, of machine learning approaches in this space, is that when people are doing the hard work, right, they know that the work they're doing right now makes their life easier into the future. And I think that's just so important, because people have become so accustomed to recreating the wheel over and over and over again. Every year going through the same steps to create the same map just to see how things have changed. In this instance, you do a lot of the hard work up front, as Nebojsa said, you let that algorithm train for days and days and days. And now it's incremental after that, right? Now, then it's just little bits of change can have transformative effects of the algorithm's accuracy across large geographic areas.
And I think the cool thing is that you can, in theory, and you tell me if I'm wrong, you can use old data with old maps to still train good models.
You can, yes, you can. So these data, I mentioned the multi-scale approaches, so the old data with 30 meters squared could be used to bootstrap the learning as well.
I see.
But our goal is to make all of that sort of kind of in the background. Basically the tool that you're using, which looks like a map, you're labeling things, you're downloading things, you're making predictions and so on, the algorithm is in the background adapting to everything you're doing and becoming better over time, so that really it's about humans using these things and communicating amongst themselves and making decisions that just over time gets easier and easier for them as a result of their previous work.
So just to finish up, the time went by really fast. It's really interesting. Where is AI for Earth going next?
As a program, this is the first big year. We were just launched last week. We're super excited to be here at Faculty Summit because we're actively looking for academic collaborations in this space. This project in particular, we'll be looking to start to deploy our algorithm at a national scale to be able to figure out just how accurate are we already and what research breakthroughs do we need to make over the next 12 months to be able to really nail this.
Awesome. Well, thanks so much for being with us, Nebojsa and Lucas. Thank you for your demo and conversation today. Thanks for your work, and thanks for making the Earth a better place.